That we have a busy day. What I will try is give you the applied surgical anatomy. So I will not go into the actual screw insertion points and where do we put the screws. This we will go in the next few lectures. And I think yesterday we had a really nice time with Dr. Menon walking us through scoliosis surgery. So when we talk about CVJ, you know, and we are basically talking about three bones. One is the occiput, the C1 or the atlas, and the axis or C2. So I'll be limiting myself to the surgical applied anatomy of these three bones. When we talk about occiput, the most important thing to remember surgically is where is it most thick. And obviously we know that it is thickest in the midline, and that is why any instrumentation that you do, the thickest part of the bone, that is the midline, should be taken while you are putting in your screws. And this is a few of the images where you should always go as high up as the external occipital protuberance, because that is the thickest part, and take few screws. This is a kind of a plate we have. We have other plates which go straight down. And here you see the problem. We all try and take bicortical purchase, but if your screw length is not proper, you have not measured what length of the screw to be put in, you will obviously go inside. And there are a lot of structures there which can be damaged. One is obviously the venous sinuses, which can be damaged. The cerebellum itself can be damaged, leading to hematoma formation. So you should be careful. And try and take bicortical purchase, but do not cross the bone significantly. C1 or the atlas again is one of the more important, I would say, bones when you come to CV junction surgically, because it is very thin. There are a lot of critical structures around it, and the most critical structure which we are scared of is the vertebral artery. So as we know, the vertebral artery comes out of the groove of the C1 and then comes out of the foramen, crosses the groove and goes into the posterior fossa. So this anatomy is there, and that's why you should be careful how much of the C1 you should expose. That's also a question which comes into mind when you're doing the posterior fossa exposure. So you have come down to the midline and then you are scared to go laterally. So we should easily, you can go up to 1.5 to 2 centimeters. And what is the point where you stop using your monopolar when you are dissecting the bone? You start to see venous bleeding. Okay, so there is always vertebral arteries, all arteries are surrounded by thick venous channels. So you will have venous bleeding first before you enter into the vertebral artery. So when you start having a lot of venous ooze and bleeding, you know that vertebral artery is close by. The other thing is, as I said, the venous channels are here, even inferiorly, because you have to access the lateral mass, there will be a lot of venous channels there. So you should not be scared of it. The three critical structures are the venous channels, the C2 ganglion with the root, and obviously the vertebral artery. As you can see, vertebral artery is very lateral. However, there could be a lot of vertebral artery anomalies, and I'll come to that later. So your screw entry point, you have to dissect out this. So don't be scared of the venous channels. You should be able to do hemostasis and reach this area. This is the lateral mass, which is hidden by the arch of the atlas. So to reach there, it is not easy. Let me tell you, you have to have a wide exposure. You have to ensure hemostasis, and you have to go quite laterally to access. So two things to remember is, one is you can go as laterally using your number one Penfield and access the lateral most part of the lateral mass. So that is number one. Number two, medially you can access this. So once you have defined the lateral mass, it sometimes is very deep in your field because the C1 is transposed anteriorly. So you should always define the medial and the lateral aspect so you know exactly where in the lateral mass you need to put your screws or do your instrumentation. So this is a cartoon of C1, and what we want to show you is your trajectory should be, I would say, when we point is at the C1 tubercle anteriorly. That is where we direct our screws. So it should be in the lower half of the anterior tubercle that you should be pointing the screws, because if you point it too high up, it has a tendency to breach the occipital cervical joint. And why is that the tendency? Because you have this huge spinous process, or not the spinous, but the arch of the C1, which is coming in the way, and that tends to push your screw trajectory superiorly. So you should be careful in case you want your trajectory to remain normal, you can nibble out the inferior part of the arch of the atlas. And this is what the points are. Sometimes it is very difficult because of bleeding and whatever reason, then how do you put your screws in? You can actually put your screw through the arch of the atlas. You understand that? And instead of going in through the lateral mass here, we can go through the arch of the atlas. So once you have defined the medial part of the lateral mass, you can approximately understand where you have to put the screw in the arch of the atlas. Once you know that, you can do it. However, you should be careful about a couple of things when you do that. And these are the two, what I am showing you is the next two x-rays. One is showing the screw which has gone through the lateral mass. Can you see? This is the lateral mass, through the lateral mass. Other has gone through the arch of the atlas. So both actually will enter into the lateral mass only, but it depends on your comfort, how comfortable you are in accessing the lateral mass of C1. Again, this is a kind of a 3D CT scan, which is you can see the orientation. This is the arch of the atlas. So if you put your screw here, you should be careful where the vertebral artery. Sometimes the vertebral artery is sloping in, and if you go a little too high, you are liable to injure it. Obviously, the venous plexus and the C2 root are there. C2 root is not too important in the sense that if you irritate the root by compressing it, or your screw goes it and it's compressing the ganglion, patient can have severe neuropathic pain. Severe neuropathic pain, which is not amenable to any measures. So if C2 root or the ganglion is coming in the way, and it will come in the way in most of the cases, because all these patients have, you know, problems. Either they have AAD, so they have constant movement of C1 over C2, which leads to thickening of the C2 root, adhesions around it. It's very thick. And so it will obviously be there right in front of the C1 lateral mass. You cannot access it, so you cut it. If you cut that C1 root proximal to the ganglion, then you have a wide surgical exposure. You do not cause neuropathic pain in the post-op period. The other thing what I want to point out is what is known as the ponticulus posticus. This is nothing except an ossified, you know, canal which lies, this is C1 arch. The artery comes in like this. However, sometimes there is a bony roof which forms over it. So this occurs in 15% of the population, and this can make you feel that the C1, the vertebral artery, is not in the way because it is covered. You will not see it. So if you put your screw here in the arch, or by drilling the arch a little bit, you are liable to damage it. So you should carefully, how do you avoid it? You carefully see the CT scan or the x-ray. It is visible. It is visible, as I said in the previous here. Can you see this? There it is visible. It is, you can see that there is a ponticulus posticus. So you should, if that is there, you should always go from inferior, the lateral mass, instead of going in through the arch of the atlas. Am I clear on this? So atlas has very few critical structures. One is obviously, as I said, the vertebral artery. C2 root or the ganglion is not critical, but you need to ensure that it is not compressed or it will lead to problems. Third is the venous plexus, which you have to care. And now fourth we come to is what lies anteriorly. We don't think about it a lot of times. There is two or three critical structures. You see laterally, quite laterally, we have the internal carotid artery. Then we have the hypoglossal nerve somewhere here. So this that is why when your screw trajectory is there, it should be directed towards the anterior tubercle, so that this area is the area which has no critical structures. I would not say really no critical structures, because there is esophagus there, trachea there, so people have gone in everywhere. So that is, but if we assume the screw you're taking a bicortical purchase and a maximum 1 millimeter, 2 millimeter anteriorly jutting out, then this C1 tubercle is the best area, because there should not cause any major damage to anything. However, if you go laterally or you are disoriented and you land up here, you can cause lot of issues. This is the anterior view. So we are seeing the C1, C2 from front. So this is the C1 anterior arch. Okay, this is the tubercle of C1, and here is the hypoglossal nerve. So it's quite lateral. It's not that it's coming here. This area is the one we should target from posterior. So have that mental picture in mind. Why we are targeting always the midline? Why can't we go straight in laterally the pars? We can go in. But if we do a bicortical purchase, then that is why when we put in a pars screw, and we'll talk about it in subsequent talks, but the surgical part I'm talking, we do not try and do a bicortical purchase in pars. That's why it's a very safe screw. A power screw is a very safe screw, because you're just putting it there. It's not going to come out anteriorly. Now I'll come to the other posterior fixation, which is very commonly done. It could be Brooke, it could be Galley's, it could be Sontag, it could be anything. Basically, it is C1, C2 wiring, right? Now, why is the anatomy is, and the very important thing which I realized early in my career while trying to do these cases is, first is the position. We try and extend to reduce. Basically, in extension only these C1, C2, this AD reduces. Now, when you extend the patient's head like this, one is your space disappears. Operative corridor is non-existent, because the patient is totally extended, you're going in and everything is vertical, you cannot make out, there is no access to C1, C2. So number one, please do not extend the head, keep it neutral, so that you have enough space surgically to see all the parts of C1 and C2 clearly. Let it be reduced while that is one common mistake, that we try and reduce the patient preoperatively or intraoperatively using the image intensifier, and then we start the surgery. It should be neutral. Open up the case. Then what you do is, you can either use your any kind of instrument and bring C1 and C2, the posterior elements together. I have seen people put in, and it's been described in literature wrongly, that this bone graft can be put between C1, C2. Never ever put the graft between C1, C2. It has to lie posteriorly. Can you see this graft? It is lying completely posterior to C1. It is not going. What happens if you put in between C1, C2? You see this cartoon, this I have made actually. This is the AAD of the patient. You understand that? So you see C1 is here, C2 is here. There's a lot of space. So this is how the patient is positioned. Now once you bring the posterior elements, this element and this element together, it will reduce. If you put anything in between them, it will distract and the AAD will again come back. Is that understood to everyone? It has not been described in this way anywhere. This is, your concept has to be clear, that if you put anything between the posterior elements of C1, C2, distract them, this AD will continue to increase. Only way it can decrease or come back to normal is that you have to get either you pull up C2 or you pull down C1. Both maneuvers are very safe. I was planning to write it up, but never got around to it. So that is why the first thing you do when you're doing a C1 C2 fixation is either you put a wire around C1 C2. So now it's in a reduced position. You can do a C1 C2 transarticular. Now everything, once you have put a wire around, you tied them together temporarily using anything. We are not talking about permanent. Temporarily in TROP, you just tie them together. After doing exposure in a neutral position, you have a reduced C1 C2. And then you can put in a trans, because anything you put in, your orientation X-ray will show a reduced C1 C2. If C1 C2 is not reducing for whatever reason, you can open up the C1 C2 joint. That will, in 100% of the cases, make it from an irreducible, partially reducible to a completely reducible AD. Okay? So this concept is extremely important. Then we come to the C2, the axis, which is again for a neurosurgeon and for every spine surgeon who's into CVJ. Is the most important bone in terms of understanding the anatomy and the surgical anatomy, and it takes a lot of time actually. You know, the pars, the pedicle, you get confused what is pars, what is pedicle, where you put in the screws. So I'll just show you here. Lamina, everybody is clear? Lamina is same as any other vertebra. This is the lamina. The lamina where it joins with the pedicle. So pedicle is like this. Can you see that? So this is this part. The pedicle actually goes in like this. The lamina joins the pedicle with the part of the bone known as pars. Is that clear? So pars is nothing but the part of the bone which is in junction with the lamina and the pedicle in case of C2. And that is why the pars screw is different, because pars screw we can put only in the pars, and a pedicle screw is different because we are going in through the pedicle.
Is it clear? Yeah, see, Miss, like anybody has, again, I'm interrupting things, like anybody has any problem in understanding anatomy or you want clarification, you can solve it rather than at a single point of time have a lecture, big lecture like that. So if at any point you want to discuss, you can discuss, and we have such a beautiful demonstration in place of you.
So this is taken from the AO screw fixation techniques, and I hope they will be repeated to you in the subsequent talks. So this is the pars screw. Now how do you put in a pars screw and a pedic screw? I will not go into details, but what Dr. Sharad will also tell you, you don't have to remember anything. 2 millimeters to up and 2 millimeters lateral, 20 or 10 degrees caudal, nothing like that. When you are operating, you see the lamina. As soon as the lamina ends, where it ends, this becomes the pars. Very clear? So as soon as you see the pars, you go in the center. Center means here is the lamina, this is the pars, here is the center. Understood? And that's where you put in the screw. And you put in the screw straight, because as I said, we are not doing a bicortical purchase in a pars screw. There is nothing there. If you put in straight here, it will just go, there is nothing there to actually breach. So you just put in, you can easily put in a 2 centimeter screw down there, very rigid construct. So it is one of the safest, one of the simplest screws to put in. Now you come to pedicle. Again, what happens is we keep remembering, but we keep forgetting also what are the points of trajectory and entry. So that is why the simplest thing is you don't remember them. Understand the anatomy better. You go laterally as you can. Feel with your number one pen, feel the edge of the C1. So you follow this, go on, keep on following, and when you feel this edge, this is the point you're supposed to enter. Again, in the mid part of the pedicles, this becomes a pedicle. Have you understood what I'm saying? So you follow with number one pen feel right up to this edge. When you reach this edge, obviously it is turning. This is the shoulder. So you cannot go more than that. You touch that point. Now you know how lateral you have to go to put in a pedicle screw. That is why your exposure has to be very wide. So you go in there, you come laterally. As soon as you come here and your number one pen field is slipping anteriorly, you know that you have reached the pedicle. At this point, you can put in your, and it is, again, it will be directed a little cranially. But it should be not angulated medially too much. We have to angle it a little laterally or straight. Understand that. Because medially will be the. So this is, don't angle it too medially. Remain here. You see that? See how laterally this entry point is. This entry point is in the midline going straight ahead. Laminar screws again are, I would say, among all the, once you understand this, all three screws are very simple, provided you have exposure. If you have lateral mass exposure, then both this pedicle and lateral mass screw becomes a very simple thing. However, if you are not able to access the lateral mass because it's very deep, there is bleeding, you don't know what's happening, you can put in a laminar screw. Laminar screw is equally strong, very good purchase, and you put in, and this is what we call as a visual screw, because you are seeing the angulation along with the lamina. You don't need to do anything. Now I'll just talk about the superior articular facet. Here you can see the facet when we are looking from top down, and here is the groove for the vertebral artery. See how the vertebral artery grooves and then goes up. Okay, so this groove of the vertebral artery, this is important because of only in cases of transarticular screws. We are not talking about transarticular screws. Is what happens is, if there is a high riding vertebral artery or there is anomalies of vertebral artery, your transarticular screw may go, C1, C2 transarticular may go and hit the vertebral artery. So there have been various types described. This is anatomy. One is very lateral, everything is very safe. See, nothing to worry, you put in a screw easily. And now when we talk about transarticular screws, see, entry point is at C3. Remember that it is very low down. You're not entering into C2, C1, C2. You're entering into from C3 onwards at the facet, C2, C3 facet. You go up. So remember that at that junction. So you have to go from really low down. Don't try and go from the midline or in the between the middle of the facet of C2. And I'll just get my arrow back. Sorry. So this type 1 and type 0 are very, very nice. You don't have any problems. Type 2, you see the vertebral artery is coming little medial. Type 3, it becomes very medial. And type 4 is the loop. So in cases, I will show you the X-ray. How do you identify an X-ray and the CT, the various types, and you avoid it. So this is also simple, provided you see. You have to see the very parasage views on the CT scan. Extreme parasage views. And when you see that, I will... So this is how the high riding vertebral artery, you will see on the later parasage view of the C2 that there is the groove of the vertebral artery is very high. There is hardly any space in the bone. It's less than 2 millimeters. You can still put in a screw provided you have image guidance and you're careful, but it is not usually recommended. However, the other thing is, when this is broad, then it becomes very, very difficult. So this internal height is also less than 2 millimeter, and the isthmus height is also less than 5 millimeter. So in these cases, it may not be safe. Another question I had in my mind was, because frequently, what is the population which comes to you with AAD? This is pediatric population. You know, small children are the ones who have AAD the most common. And I reviewed the literature and we saw that people have been putting screws, these transarticular screws, in children as small as 6 years. So anything beyond 6 years, as far as the literature goes, you can put in a transarticular screw. So this is just again a cartoon showing the various screws. This is the laminar screw. You can see how This is as soon as the lamina ends, in the midline you put in your, what you call it? Power screw, very good. You go more laterally where you your dip is laterally and you put your screw absolutely not too medially, just little ensuring that again it is pointing towards the midline anteriorly of C2 and you have the pedicle screw. Okay, and you can see the critical structures, the vertebral artery which is lateral, the C2 ganglion and the root out here, and again this is the lateral view showing again. So your this screw will come out from a C2-C3 junction for the transarticular screw. Now we come to the variations in vertebral artery. There are a lot of variations and it is not important to remember the variations. I'll talk about a few of them. It is more important to get a CT angio in every case of CVJ. Very important. And it is not important that you interpret. Let your radiologist interpret the CVJ CT angio. So whenever we get a CT of the CVJ, that's a standard protocol in our institution. We get a CT CVJ for all patients who have AAD or of any kind of CVJ anomaly. We have made it mandatory that a CT angio will be done with it. And there have been so many theses with Dr. Kale as guide. They have all shown that there's a very high rate of, you know, anomalies in the vertebral arteries and other anomalies in CVJ. So you should always get it done. I will not go into detail. I will just show you few anomalies. This is from, I've given you the references, so if you want, I mean, anybody can go through them. Most common anomalies is, one, there is duplication. You know, what we call as the fenestration. So there is a fenestration, so one is going close to the C1, C2 joint. So obviously your C1 lateral mass, when you're accessing, it may get damaged. Number two, when you're opening the C1, C2 joint, if you're doing anything there, it may get damaged. So you have to be careful about it. The second thing is, there is a persistent first intersegmental artery. So what is happening is, this is the intersegmental artery. It's actually the vertebral artery goes in anterior to the lateral mass, and this is very, very dangerous because you may obviously damage it if you use any of our methods. Then anomalous origin of pica has been described. So what is happening is, here I'll show you, this is the anomalous origin of the pica. So here we can see that from here, this there is a origin vessel coming out and going in, and this is becoming the pica. Can you see this? This is becoming the pica. So this actually can lead to an infarct if you damage it anyway. Vertebral artery itself is not damaged, but pica gets damaged. If C1 is occipitalized, which happens in a very very commonly, large majority of the patients, you know, with CV junction anomalies, vertebral artery will automatically have some anomalies. You have to be very careful. They may, there are various types described, and you know, vertebral artery may ride completely in front of you as soon as you expose, liable to damage, may be absent on one side. So first thing first, very simple, find out which side is dominant. That is the most important thing for everyone to, it's not difficult. Whenever you operate a CVJ, find out, have a question in your mind, which vertebral artery is dominant. So you know that that part you will do last. If it's on the right side, you will do last side, right side last. First you'll play around with the left side, so that anything happens, damages, you know that right, you still have the dominant vertebral artery. Next question is there any major anomalies in the vertebral artery? And what is the axis? So if you have this kind of a vertebral artery is going in front of you, you either avoid it, because although people talk about transposition and everything, we all know it's not going to happen very in day-to-day practice. Nobody is going to transpose vertebral arteries just to access a screw. You have so many choices for screw fixation. And again I'm telling, don't in any kind of surgery, number one, how you choose, it is not based on literature, please. You do not choose what screw to put in bare based on literature. You choose it based on what screw you can place safely. Patient comes first. So if you do not know transarticular screw, because literature says transarticular, it doesn't mean that you have to put in a transarticular screw. Whatever you are confident and safe. So if you know only occipital cervical fusion, which may be causing patient complete immobilization, it's still the best procedure for you in your hands, because it is the safest. You have to understand that. The priorities are not, literature is not dictating the priorities. The complication rates are dictating the priorities. So if you think in your hands occipital cervical fusion, there is no harm in it, I'm telling you. Whatever people might say, if it is the safest and best technique for you, you please go ahead with it. Number two, then you see what is there. If you are feeling that C2 lateral mass is not is a problem for you, put in translaminar screws. They are the safest. It is not that you have to, learning will always continue, but patient will always come first. So you have to understand, remember the screws, whenever you get a chance, it's a simple case, anatomy is clear, vertebral artery is not anomalous and not coming in the way, you do whatever you want. But wherever you feel a little less confident, do the safest thing. Now I'll just talk briefly about odontoid fracture and the basically surgical anatomy. We all know the treatment decision for odontoid fracture is based on the integrity of the transverse ilial ligament. Okay, so what we do for that, because we have to decide whether we do a odontoid screw fixation or we do a posterior fixation, C1, C2 fixation. So for that, MRI is the gold standard. I am just showing you where you look for this axial image. You can see this structure, which is appearing hypointense anterior to the cord, is the transverse anal ligament. And how does it appear in the injured state? Here again, you can see this has gone. On the right side, this transverse anal ligament has gone. It is still preserved here. Here it is gone. Lot of hyperintensity is there because edema and fluid have come. So any hyperintense signals in T2 is the important imaging, the in T2 imaging, MRI, all these hyperintense signals you see on a scan are indicative of injury, tissue edema, understand, or fluid. So this T2 signal is showing there is a lot of fluid everywhere. Both of them are T2. This is in a normal patient, this is in a injured patient, that's all. So you can see how much hyperintensity has increased everywhere compared to this scan. Another small point for screw fixation posteriorly, especially transarticular or any kind of thing, you have to remember that if you do not maintain the patient, if you fix the patient, you know, in extension too much, patient may develop subsequent kyphosis. So you have to be careful about this also. So you have to ensure that lordosis is maintained when you are fixing the patient. Otherwise, because of the forces which are coming down, subsequently patient will develop a swollen deformity. So be careful about your positioning of the patient in the OR also. So this was, there's so much in surgical anatomy, but I had to finish in 15 minutes. So this was in brief. Any questions or any clarifications? Because we'll have subsequent talks by the faculty, which will go in actual detail of the techniques. Thank you so much.